In this video, I plan to show you one particularly nasty kind of a bug. It is a very old kind of bug. It's been there since the beginning of programming, but it is still actual in modern programming. What makes it worse, what makes it interesting but in a bad way, is that it specifically likes complex domain models. I will show you how the bug manifests, how you make it. I will show you two solutions to that sort of bugs. And a third solution that completely dismisses it, if you want to go that way. So you better stay with me for this entire video. There's a lot of code I want to show you. Please join me in the demo. This is the core domain model I will be working with. The company. The company has a collection of addresses. Both the company and the address models are mutable. That will make the situation much more complicated for me. Because addresses come with some validation. Look at the method which adds an address. It validates the new object and then adds it to the internal mutable collection. The address, which is a billing address, must be in the same country in which the company has been incorporated. The add method validates that, so I'm very happy. But I see a bug here. If I'm changing the country code in the company, I must check billing addresses in the company. So I have apparently plugged one obvious validation deficiency in my class. Am I safe? Is this class good now? Let's try it. There will be a company. There will be a valid billing address in it. I will save it to database that would assign IDs to both objects assigned by the database itself, I don't care. And if I tried to add another billing address later with a different country, I know already that would fail. Just as a proof, I will run the application, you will see that there was the exception. So my validation apparently works. What I did here was traditional validation of mutable objects. There is that rule that every object should be created and maintained valid for its entire lifetime. So as it appears, I'm doing precisely that in this model. But let me check a different use case. Later on, I will load that same company from the database and I will try to modify the address details. Set the new street, set the new country code, save it to database, and this is what will be in the database after I do it. When I run the application, the result will be an obvious invalid company with the US country of incorporation and the Canada as the billing address. My model is expressly violating the validation rules I was supposed to preserve. How did this happen? What you see here is called the aliasing bug, and as I said, it is one of the oldest bugs in programming. It happens when there is a shared reference to an object. So the company object is holding an address, but also that main function there where I was demonstrating was also holding the reference to the same address object. And while the address object was valid while it was put into the company object, into the internal collection, which is encapsulated, by the way, what happened later was that I have modified that same instance of the address class without telling the company object that I'm changing it. So the company had no opportunity to validate it again. Can you imagine the consequences of poking with shared references this way in an object graph that consists of 200 objects, for example? I have seen this kind of a bug, the aliasing bug, in production like 3 times in my career. These bugs are very difficult to locate first because you don't know which part of your code is modifying your objects in a very complicated application. And then, when you figure it out, you get even more desperate because you don't know how to fix it. I will now show you two principal ways to address this bug so that it doesn't happen. The first one you probably won't like. I will just accept my fate. I know there are shared references. I will add a public method, isValid, which would let anyone who modifies anything to check the root object and ask it to validate now after the fact and tell you whether you broke something. So this would be the opportunity for the company object to check all the elements of its state. The stress is then on the caller. The caller would be responsible to invoke the isValid method before persisting any changes it made. So there could be a tremendously complicated logic here. And when everything ends, then you ask if something was broken. If not, continue with the persistence, otherwise cancel everything. This tactic is effective, it's very simple, but it is flawed because you can still forget to check the validity. So this is the quick and dirty solution. The true solution is to retain control of the contained objects. Look how I did it with the addresses collection. There is a private list which is mutable, but I will never give that mutable list to any caller. The public addresses property is a read-only list. That is a typical way in which we encapsulate mutable collections. I want to implement a similar process on the addresses, so that the addresses become read-only too. That will be a much better solution, and it will be a solution that really works. Before that, let me remind you that this entire channel is free and all the videos on it are free, but only thanks to the sponsors. If you like what you have learned from this video so far and from other videos on my channel, then please consider joining the growing community of patrons on my Patreon page. That would give you access to the source code of this video and all other videos, and also some goodies that are not available on YouTube alone. Thank you very much. Now let's get back to code. When I said I want a read-only address, this is what I meant. A separate type which is read-only and contains all the data the address has. Back in the address, down below, I will add a method that turns an immutable address object into a read-only variant by copying all the values and references into the new DTO. And then we are back in the company class. Instead of just returning a read-only variant of the list, I want more. I will project each address into its read-only variant and return that. In this way, the caller won't be able to modify anything. Let me show you. All lines that are modifying the address are red. It's not possible to do that. All I can do is to create a new instance of the read-only address with modified data. Then, instead of just asking whether the company is valid, because it is, I would behave similar to adding the address. There would be an update method which updates an address by receiving the modified, the new read-only variant of that same address. So let's implement it. It will be very simple. The update method would accept the read-only address, perform a complete validation. There are quite a lot of details here. Otherwise, if all validations passed, the company object itself would modify its contained address object. So the root object becomes responsible for the correctness and the modifications made to everything inside it. That is completely different compared to shared references. The last place I need to modify to plug all the holes is to forbid passing an actual mutable address into the company. It would receive the read-only address and create its own private instance which nobody can see. and then add it into the list, of course. That, once again, affects the caller. It would pass a DTO into the company, which retains full control. And this is all. Now you see how I'm solving the aliasing bug by not allowing shared references to leak out of the object, of the mutable object that controls them. Everything the caller can do is to work with the immutable read-only addresses. What you see here is the full solution, which is complicated. It only imitates immutable design. If you pay close attention, I'm literally imitating immutability here. And you see the way out already. The proper solution to aliasing bugs is to ditch mutability entirely. Design a fully immutable domain model, and bugs of this kind will never exist.